The Log4j vulnerability brings new awareness to a topic and an issue that's been plaguing the security industry for some time, that is software supply chain risk. And here to dive deeper into the topic with us is Tim Morris. He is a cybersecurity expert at Tanium. So welcome, Tim.
Thanks for having me, Maggie.
So first off, what is software supply chain and what are the risks associated with it?
Well, the risk is when you talk about a supply chain, you're talking about things that were used to make a product. We can use analogies like I bought a new pair of jeans this weekend and there were like seven tags on it. It's like, why does it have to have so many tags? There are regulations that say you had to, your mattress, your pillows, even your food ingredients, there's regulation on what has to be in there. You have to list the ingredients or pharmaceuticals. Software is no different. You know, it is made by a bunch of components. How it's made is determined by the vendor that's making it. It can be a commercial product where they use everything in-house they're making, and you'll see components in file systems like DLL files or even configuration files like .xmls, .ini, and recently in Log4j, the Java repository. So you'll see jar, ear, and war, which are just like Russian dolls of compressed files. So you send out these components. And in the open source software world, where not really free, people, instead of writing, say, an authentication page for a web page, you would just go grab one and open source. Instead of creating your own tunneling software, you would just go get one like OpenSSH. And anyway, all of these things in the middle that go to make this becomes part of the supply chain. If you think in a physical sense, years ago, it's still not a threat or could be a threat. If you buy an appliance, say for your home, there's chips in there. If there's malware in those chips, that would be considered a supply chain risk, because sometimes you contact a vendor to get a bill of materials on what's in there. Sometimes they don't even really know. Now, if they did all themselves, they may know. But I remember managing some network appliances one time, and I contacted the vendor and asked, which plant are these made in? Because we had to do some third-party risk assessment. They couldn't tell me what country they were coming from. And I'm like, well, if you don't know what country they're coming from, where are the chips on those boards coming from? So anyway, all of this kind of makes up supply chain risk. And in software, it's a little different and sometimes ubiquitous, because it could be made in different places by a third party, in-house. It could be open source that somebody just grabbed. There's lots of ways that can get software into a supply chain. Therefore, that's why it's also a big risk and a big target.
And I read a study that supply chain attacks likely increased fourfold last year. So what makes the supply chain so attractive to attackers?
Well, a couple things. If you go back to the old, you know, Trojan horse, and we used to call malware that, Trojan horses, you get bad malware inside of good malware. Well, what if you could take some good malware and attach to that? It doesn't look bad to the people running it. If you think back to 2020 with the SolarWinds attack and that software, since it was a network utility for lots of companies, it was on allow list. So it was a trusted vendor. So therefore the application itself was trusted. And by default, you're trusting all the components in it. No, now, yes, you can do security code reviews. So anything that was happening, while it may show up in logs or to security operations floor or fusion center floor, they may not notice it because we know that software, that's good. So that is one reason it makes it a target. Secondly, you don't know the impact you'll have, or you have a greater impact. Also, the attack surface changes over the years. People, if you think about the years like in 08, 09, 010, or 2010, you had the big DDoS attacks, and then you saw a graduation into more ransomware destructive type attacks. And it seems like every year things kind of move. Also, the adoption of open source software or the adoption of these shared components says, okay, I have a better attack surface if I can concentrate on that area and kind of Trojanize it, if you will, and get into it.
And you touched on something else I wanted to discuss with you, is the evolution of supply chain risk. I know before coming to Tanium, you spent several decades leading cybersecurity teams in the banking industry. So how have you seen this evolve?
Quite a bit. So my first foray into banking was a software packager. And one of the first jobs I had was to do just this, ironically, and that was to dissect software packages and understand every component that was in them. Back in the Windows days, you had DLLs, it called DLL conflicts, and you get these Windows errors, you know, back with NT4.0 before we got to Windows 2000 and Windows 95, all those operating systems. So we would literally dissect every package and catalog those components. And I remember then thinking, you know, we call a piece of software good, but if one of these dynamic link libraries was bad, you could create all kinds of havoc with it. So as you know, coincidence or destiny or providence, whatever you want to call it, would have it, you know, fast forward. And when I moved into cybersecurity, you started seeing a lot of network-based attacks. That's when we had the moat and drawbridge. So you protect your perimeter. But as, you know, the industry has grown, especially with like COVID and many more people working at work. When I was at the bank, you know, we had about 60,000 people working remotely. When COVID hit, it went to 215,000. So our attack surface, while we did protect those laptops, just overnight, within like 3 weeks, now we had this dispersion. So all those perimeter controls we had, you know, have moved. So now the endpoint itself is the perimeter. You know, it is what is provided. That's why you'll hear terms like zero trust, you know, and how do you, you know, manage the attack surface there? Because not only is your network an attack surface, over the years it's graduated that the endpoint becomes the attack surface. And then within the endpoint, the applications, and then within those, the configuration and components. So it keeps drilling, you know, deeper and deeper down. Just like as we study genomes and DNA, the more we uncover, the more we learn there is to know. Well, software applications is the same thing. We have researchers digging deeper and deeper, trying to find what's the dependency on this. So over the years, we saw network-based DDoS attacks. You see web interface attacks, like, you know, SQL injections or cross-site scripting, you know, on web servers, you know, to try to get in. And those are kind of in your face, and they're still valid. They still work. To the, you know, phishing attacks. Let me just try to get something inside, run, you know, a piece of malware that can phone back home to a command and control server, and I can take over that machine and then work from the inside out, say move laterally, or there's insider threats. I remember one year that was the biggest, you know, the contractors we have come in. What about the third parties we've contracted to? What about their subcontractors, which are now fourth party risk or X party risk? So the risk portfolio or that attack surface keeps growing and growing, and it just gets more and more complicated.
So it sounds like cybersecurity in general, the challenges have just gotten bigger and bigger over the years. So what are the problems organizations face when they try to secure their supply chain?
So the first thing is understanding where everything's at. I mean, you have to understand what you have internally. So the big questions I always ask, or my boss always infiltrated or made us know, is, you know, what, first of all, we need to define our networks. What is our network? What devices are on them? And our network doesn't mean on premise. It means what is connecting to our applications, to our networks from the outside, whether they be sitting at a public Wi-Fi spot or in their home or at a hotel. We need to know what applications are running. And what we're seeing with supply chain, the difficulty is not just knowing what computers I have and what applications are on them. Now I have to know what components are used to make those applications run. And even more so, which I think will happen more in the next few years, is the component itself may be secure by default, but there are configurations that can be turned on and off. So now the component is not at fault, but a configuration of the component is now a problem. Because in every one of these, if you look at struts, if you look for log4j, there's a configuration component that whether it's turned on or off, or you could go affect it, you could change the behavior. So the cyber attack surface and the difficulty is you got to get to that level. And the other thing is, we live in an open and a global society. So when you get into, you know, large enterprises that are trying to define just their third party risk management, you know, who are we paying money to? What are we getting from them? What supplies, what services, what software, what hardware? How do we know that what's in there, it can be trusted? One of those other questions we always ask is, what do I look like to an attacker? And that attacker can be on the outside looking in, or could be sitting at your admin desk looking out.
What are some best practices you can share for protecting and securing your supply chain?
Well, the first and foremost, if you go look at the any kind of framework like the NIST, you have to know what you have on your network. You have to know what applications are running. And right now that sounds simple, and I don't want to belittle the point, but it's not. So we here preach IT hygiene, cyber hygiene. I always boil it down to those three words, know, manage, secure. You can't secure what you don't manage, and you can't manage what you don't know. And that's what I always try to instill in my teams. You know, every time we get a vulnerability, whether it be a zero day that's coming in or something that's 6 months old that should have been patched 5 months ago, or, you know, 6 months minus 3 days ago, is we need to know what it is we have and what it is we're running. We also need to understand what the risk that folks have accepted, you know, because some people will know like, yeah, this is a little risky, but I'm okay because I have these compensating controls or these mitigating controls. So to secure ourselves, one is asset inventory. You have to know what's running. That also includes configuration management, which is still eluding some of the largest enterprises, you know, that we have to do that. So those are two of the biggest things that we need to do. But then when you look at what do you know you look like to an attacker, that goes into your offensive security research, you know, how you look at your workflows, look at your processes, look at your people, what it is that they have. There's the basics like least privilege, you know, where are your crown jewels out? Who has access to those? How do they have access to those? Is it one Active Directory group? Is it air gapped? All those kind of things you have to do to secure, you know, your not just your network, but your computers and your applications.
How does Tanium help its customers address supply chain risk?
Well, the biggest thing Tanium does is, one, Tanium is a platform. It was built on a communications protocol. And that protocol is so fast, it allows you to get back answers very, very quickly. So one of the things we ask for every vulnerability that comes in is, does this matter? You know, does it matter to me? It may have a high CVSS score, but if it's not running in my environment, it doesn't matter. So I'll give it a low one. Vice versa, it may have a mid-level CVSS score, but I have it everywhere. So therefore I have a higher. So knowing that inventory with Tanium, being able to know what's on my network, this is a platform, being able to ask questions and get them back super fast. And that whole Russian doll that I was talking about, you know, looking at the computers on the network, check, Tanium can do that. Applications running on them, check, I can do that. Applications installed, but not running, I can do that. And then I can get into other components like we did with Log4j, whether it be index or reveal, I can drill down even further into contents of the files and even down to configurations and determine that. That's very, very important. So that can help. The other thing is, because we're on the endpoint, everything is there locally, it's cache, and I can do forensics analysis, that same security data helps with my ops team and my asset inventory that I can go look and say, hey, maybe I can create a bill of materials, you know, myself. I can see an application running. I can see the dependencies it's running to, like what servers it's connecting to, what other endpoints it's connecting to, but just in itself, what is it calling? What file paths and files are it using? Is it using? And then when you do see something that where Tanium really, really helps, I mean, I was at the bank, we had, like, I call it Noah's Ark, two of everything. You would see a blip somewhere, whether that be your next gen AV, your EDR, XDR tool, or something on the network. The next thing you would do is go to Tanium and then go see what happened. What application was it? What process down to that level? And then you can pivot, you can scope, you can target and say, is this a bad thing? Like if it's connecting to a command and control server in a country that you don't trust, then yes, that's bad. If it's trying to send credentials out, that's bad. If it's trying to download payload from a normal, you know, binary that you wouldn't expect to see, that's bad. But sometimes you don't know. And the ability to take that information and then look across your environment and get that answer back in seconds is what sets Tanium apart from any other tool. Most, even the EDR and XDR tools, you got to go to the cloud. There's at least a 6-hour latency, and nothing's worse than when you're doing an incident response or forensics case to get to machine that you know something happened on that you need to investigate, and you get there and the data's not there. Either it didn't get back to that. Well, with Tanium, or there's so much traffic on it, it had been tuned to only collect data. You know, we told them 30 days, but we only have data for 3 hours because the logs roll off so fast. Well, with Tanium, because the only cost there, other than license cost, is the storage on the box, I can have 30, 60, 90 days, you know, depends on how much I want to give it. And now I can go look back, and most attacks, you're investigating in the first 3 to 7 days, if not immediately right now. And again, that's what sets Tanium apart, is that I can do all this asset inventory. I can pivot, I can scope, I can hunt, and you do this response in real time, because intel I get right now that happened 2 minutes ago may change the direction I'm going. And if I'm using data from 3 days ago, that's not going to make me a very effective hunter or a very effective incident responder, or in that case in IT ops, a very good asset manager, because I don't have, you know, fresh data.
Wow, this is amazing. And I'm sure a topic that we'll be talking about for the rest of the year, if not years to come, right, Tim?
Yes, we will. Yeah, Log4j has Strut's taught us a lot, and it got us ready for what Log4j brought in. But then Log4j just brought in a whole nother level that, you know what, even as mature, and I've been doing this for 20 some years, we're still not there yet. You know, we don't have, you know, the tags on the jeans or the pillows or the mattresses that says illegal to take them off, you know, till you get them home. We don't have that for software yet. And hopefully soon, you know, we will get that. We do have it when you, like what I call make your own sausage. If you write the software, you can build a catalog of materials. But when you install something and they don't give you that ingredient list, like that box of macaroni, we have to create our own. So hopefully, you know, we can come up with something here soon that can be able to do that for us.
Absolutely. Because as we always say, there will be another one, right?
Always. There were 22,000 vulnerabilities last year. That's like 55 per day if you didn't take weekends and holidays off. Log4j just happened to be one of the bigger ones, but you got Kaseya, Print Nightmare, but over 20,000, 22,000. Yeah, there was probably, you know, 15, 20 more than time we've been talking.
Unbelievable. Well, thank you so much for diving deeper into this topic with us and sharing your insights and stories. I love them all. So thank you so much, Tim.
Thank you, Maggie.